one of the all written again express a deep appreciation for this piece, and also to express appreciation for the good singing we've had. Brother Hagerman does an excellent job, and is a great lover of truth, and it's wonderful to have the privilege of singing with him. I am pleasantly surprised that Brother Ben Big and Brother Dean have come all the way from Indianapolis. About 180 miles, I believe they are, someone said. And there may be some members, in fact, you and I both know that it's true that somebody in this congregation has come maybe even a few miles or a few blocks. So that shows a very great love of the truth. Brother Dick is a graduate of the Memphis School of Preaching and is an outstanding gospel preacher and an excellent writer and a good debater. And I'm glad he's in this state of Indiana. I'm glad that he's in Indianapolis. Brother Dean, I believe, may have led the singing when I preached in a meeting at Shelbyville Road several years ago. It's wonderful to see both of them, and all of you, especially one who is not a member of the Church of Christ. Now, in this meeting, we've been using as a theme, what must I do? We began Sunday morning by talking about what do you see in life? And at the Sunday morning worship hour, we discussed what must I do to be saved. And Sunday evening, we discussed what church does God approve. Which one? And there is only one, as we saw from our study of the Bible, and most of you already told you that. And then last evening, what kind of home does God approve? And we talked about some of the positive aspects of the home, and then we talked about some who teach the false doctrine and therefore attack the home, and both on the outside, such as homosexuality, though that may be a problem in both places, but even in high places today, all the way to the presidency, there are those who favor and push it, to say the least of it. We discussed a number of the theories, even among brethren that have taught, and all of them beginning with different premises, making different arguments, and all of them coming to the same unscripted conclusion, which the master is, though they wouldn't word it that way, but I would, because that's the essence of it. Really arguing that you can live in adultery with God's approval and go to heaven. Now, you can't do that, as we pointed out last evening. But now tonight, we're discussing what must I do, what must we do, when enemies of the truth arise. Now, there have always been enemies of the truth. That was true in Paul's day. You remember in Philippians 3:18 and 19, Paul said, for many walk, notice, not just a few, but many. For men walk of whom I told you often, and now tell you even weeping, he was crying when he wrote that letter, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is perdition, whose God is the valley, and whose glory is in their shame, who man earthly things. You know, I've thought a number of times through the years about the things that made Paul cry. You can tell a great deal about a man's character, what makes him cry, and or what makes him laugh. Paul cried when he thought about the enemies of the cross. Paul cried when he thought about the impending apostasy. As he spoke of that to the elders from Ephesus, addressing them to his Miletus. In Acts 20, 28 through 31, he said, take ye unto yourselves and all the flock, in which the Holy Spirit has made you bishops. The American Standard says, the King James overseers have made you bishops. To feed the church of the Lord, which he purchased with his own blood. I know that after my departing, grievous wolves shall enter among you, that is, enter in among the eldership, and I never see the folk of Rome that I do not think of that passage. He and the Roman Catholic Church are living evidences of the fact that the apostasy did occur, and it began within the eldership of the church of the Lord. And from among your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things as all his disciples after them. Now he says in verse 31, wherefore watch ye. How we need to watch. Watch ye. Remember that for the space of 3 years, I cease not to admonish everyone, night and day, but notice, with tears. when the Christian church left us and became a denomination, it was an inside job. That's what's happening today. And then this place, you know the expression, all the water in the world cannot sink the ship as long as it's on the outside. It's when the water gets inside that it sinks the ship. And so Paul cried when he thought about the impending apostasy. And you know, when he wrote the First Corinthian letter, he was crying when he wrote that letter. I don't know whether the tears fell on the letter, on the paper or not. It doesn't make any difference where they fell. The point is they did fall. And I didn't realize that he was crying when he wrote about that a man having married his father's wife until one day I was reading 2 Corinthians 2:4. He said, for out of much affliction and anguish of heart, I wrote unto you with many tears. When Brother David Livingston died, those who embalmed him at the funeral home were amazed that his knees were so callous. And they didn't understand that because they were told the reason he had so many calluses on his knees, he spent so much time on his knees praying when digressives were trying to bring him to the music to the missionary society. And it's time for us to do our praying, but standing up for the truth in an old and honorable way, in every way that we have opportunity. That's big. You remember that Paul said about the Judaizing and teachers in 2 Galatians 2:4-5, that that because of the false brethren, privilege brought in, who came in privilege, and that word privilege comes from a Greek word that means to bring in the side door undercover. You know, that's the way the enemy took a lot of the congregations. They copied up a lot of people into it. They'd get around and they would get their confidence. My hometown, Woodbury, Tennessee, I grew up just about 5 minutes outside of the town. And my own community, the Elkins community, the only congregation there is the church. And my father led us in there 15 years, my brother later, and my uncle was an elder and so on. But I preached my first sermon in town. And that brother man was a man called Bill Lewis, man. He was a man guy. He wanted me to come there for me in earlier days. And by the time the scheduling years hit, by the time I got there, he was a full-fledged anti-Semite. But some of the elders would not admit it. They didn't want to face up to the problem. I saw them with tears in their eyes after he and others had split the church up. And I went there for a meeting. Jim Cope's mother-in-law was there, brother-in-law, and there were others, and there were business people. Some of them had encouraged me to preach, and dear friends of mine through the years, as far as I knew, and they went off into that. We had day services. And I took the book of James so I could discuss it expository and get to James 1:27. And they were very unhappy with me. And a lot of it came out as a result of it being preached on and so on. But at the end of time, and I asked him, why didn't you have enough courage to get up here and tell people what you really believe instead of copy cutting them into it? That's what a lot of folks do. Now that's the way digressive tactics are often. They gain people's confidence. They slip up on the blind side. They approach people by being nice to them and all that kind of thing by way of their personalities. And many of them do have good personalities. But that's the Judaizing teachers came in that way. And Paul said in that because of the false brethren, privilege brought in, who came in privilege, to spy out our liberty which we have in Christ Jesus, in other words, that they might bring us into bondage. Now, question. Paul, how long did you wait to oppose them? To whom we gave place in the way of subjection, no, not for an hour, that the truth of the gospel might continue with you. Now, Paul was not a man who was just going around spoiling for a fight. And you know, frankly, I do not enjoy controversy. I wish we never had to have it. I wish everybody did like it. But I enjoy controversy far more than I do compromise, because compromise will cause you to lose your soul. Now Paul said, follow me, 1 Corinthians 11:1, be ye imitators and followers of me as I also am of Christ. So Paul didn't wait for an hour to oppose that one. There are so many different areas wherein error is being advocated today that I frankly do not have the time to discuss it all, but I can think of it. I might not think or know about all of it. But I want to mention just enough you look at the roster of the so-called Jubilee, and it's really a who's who list of breaking news of many of the well-known liberals among us. But there are those who are saying that we are a denomination. But you know, a man doesn't live in the proof of denomination. I preached on that the other night, so I don't have the time. I'm not going back into that again myself. But you know what? I have tested people who said we're a denomination. And as Alexander Campbell founded the Church of Christ, I was in a meeting when I lived in Perry County near the Tennessee River. There was no congregation there, and the brethren were out to preach and thought they should have opportunity to hear the gospel. So we got a gymnasium, and I preached in the gymnasium. And we had a bus, and there was some distance away. We all rode together down there. We had a question box. You know, used to, we had that in many of our meetings. And I would go over every night. I think it was about a week's meeting, as I recall. I would go over to the question box, and I had no questions up to this particular night, and it was almost time again that night when we got there. And I went over there and opened the lid of the box, and had four questions. I think I can remember maybe all of them, maybe at least three of them, maybe all of them, but I won't mention but one. A Mormon preacher was there that night with a number of his denomination, his congregation from that denomination. And I learned later that he didn't put those questions here. Now, here was one. He was wrong on every point. Here's the one I want to mention. And I mentioned that because I have to think about when I'm talking about the church not being a denomination. He said, Alexander Campbell founded the Church of Christ. Now, you old man trying to prove that would be like a blind man in a dark cell looking for a black cat, but it's not there to begin with. It's impossible. He said, Alexander Campbell founded the Church of Christ. He said he did it for the money. Now, can you imagine him such a church and say, he said he did it for money. What other reason had you believed in the Church of Christ? Well, I pointed out, of course, that Alexander Campbell married a wealthy woman. He didn't have to have support. But at the same time, he and all of us who know the Bible know that the Bible says it's proper to support a preacher. For in 1 Corinthians 9:14, even so hath the Lord ordained that they that preach the gospel truly of the gospel. But those who do not preach the truth should certainly not be supported of faithful gospel. And then I said, I'm going to test whoever put this question in the box, and I suspected it was he because I knew who he was. He made other sarcastic remarks about the church. I said, now I do not have $1,000. But I have brethren, so I see the sheriff of the county was in the church, some of the officials in the courthouse, and they were with us that night. And I knew they had the money, and I knew I could borrow the money, but I knew there wasn't no need for it anymore. I said, I am going to make this offer to anybody in this audience. I will give anybody in this audience $1,000 if you will stand where you are. And you don't have to give two things. You just give one thing that I was taught to believe in obeying the gospel or to practice in worship or to live in Christian life. One thing that originated with that exact account, and I will give you $1,000. And I just paused and got very, very quiet. And then I said, furthermore, I will give anybody in this audience $1,000 if you will point out even one thing that I teach people to do that originated in country Christian living, Christian life, worship, and serving God, that originated in Alexander County. And I just let there be a long delivery pause. And nobody said anything. But he went away, so I looked over and said, we still can't relax. Well, don't you know he would have gotten up and embarrassed me and taken that $1,000 if he had shown that we could do something to start at the county. I've been in Ireland, and I've been in the anti-murder C. Cedar Presbyterian building, that's what it used to be, when Thomas Campbell preached there. I've been in that building, it still stands. But before Thomas Campbell came to this country, and that exactly, there were members of the Church of the Lord in this country, but if there hadn't been none, they just preached the gospel. And the Bible says in Luke 8:11 that the parable of this deceived is the word of God. things that are fundamentally irrelevant to the world's crisis needs. Well, you know, Christ said, I will build my church, and furthermore, Ephesians 3:10-11, to the intent and now to the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be made known through the church of manifold wisdom of God. Yet he says it's irrelevance. And if you, according to the eternal purpose which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord, listen, a man won't be happy over the judgment that he made fun of the church where he is salvation. But he also says this, and I didn't read this the other night. He says the restoration movement started out as an appeal for unity of Christians. Somewhere along the line, maybe 50 years ago, we abandoned that theme. And we crystallized and we came to a large measure what we set out to propose. That's a pretty hard lecture a few years ago, shortly after he made this statement. I went to the microphone here in question and answer here, and I quoted this the day before he came. Well, the next day he was there, so I went to my, I didn't mention his name the first day, but I went back the next day, and I mentioned it again. But he didn't reply, he didn't say anything at all. He also said, and come on, I when I'm talking about worship, I might read that, but if I think of it. But you know, he has also said that if instrument music were brought in where he preached, if the elders decided he said to bring it next Sunday, he said he would not stand up and hold it and divide the church. I'll tell you, the fellow who divided the people thought he brought it in. And then he said that he would have a conscience question as to whether or not he failed. He said, I would not draw a line and say that let those who stand with me step across the line and so on. And those Christian church preachers roared with laughter when he said, he made that statement before several hundred Christian church preachers, and a couple of my friends were there and recorded that's what he said. I got to record on it. But when they had that discussion, when Brother Woodson and Brother Hires and Munro Hawley and Rubel had the discussion down the back of the music, I also went to the microphone that day and I quoted that statement and I said, now I would like to Brother Shelley to reconcile two statements. And I quoted this statement where he said he wouldn't stand up and oppose it if they brought it in where he preached. By the way, there was a time when he would stand up and oppose it. I know that would be a fact, I think. But I said, now several years ago, you did not oppose it. And the later the Christian church preacher, Wayne Dunning, and by the way, he did a good job. I've read the book, have the book, and I've heard the statements. And we gave $1,000. I started to say that that day. I didn't say that, but it was in truth. We gave $1,000 to send him that thing. Because there was not a congregation nearby to do that, they said. So Al Flat moderated. Some other congregations, two or three, that we gave $1,000. I think it was money well spent. But you know what he did? By the end of that, he observed the Passover. He just passed right over and said nothing. Now, in earlier days, he stood for the truth. But now, listen to what he says. There are sincere, not a lot of what he said on this matter, that about 50 years ago we abandoned the thing. We didn't give up the truth 50 years ago, or and we didn't become a denomination 50 years ago, or there may be people who go out from us who become one, but play for brevity. He said they're sincere, knowledgeable, devout Christians scattered among all of the various denominations. Well, you know what? What happens in many cases is that these fellows will go to Romans 14, which is talking about matters of expediency. Whether you eat meat or not eat meat, as a matter of fact. And then they'll bring up matters of faith, like we said on music, I've heard Christian church preachers, even some of our brethren do it, and throw that into that category. It's unscientific and not rightly divided. The word of truth. There are those who return the church of our Lord into denominations. Into denominations. But there are those that are in it of the cause out here in the world many places who deny the very existence of God. They're in it of the truth. You know, the Bible says in Psalm 19:22, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament show its handiwork. Day unto day, utter speech, and night unto night, show knowledge. There is no speech, no language, where there was. It is not heard. not in, you have to have a written revelation. But in Romans 1:20, for the invisible things of him since the creation of the world are clearly seen, being perceived through the things, notice, that are made, through the things that are made, that they may be without excuse. In other words, even if everlasting power and divinity, that they may be without excuse. Many years ago, I was in London in the British Museum, and I was three other brethren. And we were looking at those old manuscripts of the Bible and some other old manuscripts. And a brother, there were two ladies in this brother that was along. And he was struggling to read the Hebrew in one of those manuscripts. And a man walked up behind us, and he began to read it fluent. And I turned to him and asked him, "Are you a Hebrew?" And he said, "Yes." But he said, "I want to give you to understand that I'm an atheist. I don't believe there's any God. And I don't have any use for the Bible. I'm a part of an atheistic organization." He said, "Birmingham, England." We would say Birmingham. And so I removed my watch and I said, "Now, I have this watch. It has a band, it has hands, it has jewels, etc. Would you believe that somebody was, that this watch could make it say?" He said, "Well, I know I wouldn't believe that. By that time, people had gathered around, we had a pretty good crowd before we finished." But I said, "Well, suppose you're out in the wilderness, and you see a house, and you never see anybody, you never see a human, would you believe that house built itself?" He said, "No, if there's a house, then that says somebody built it." And I said, "Well, you're exactly right. And Hebrews 3:4 says, for every house is built with some man, but he that built all things in God, he that didn't believe a watch he could build himself, or a house, and many things that you heard, just being in existence." I think I was grown before I ever met an atheist. There won't be any on the day of judgment, of course. But there are many atheists in our country. And then there are those who deny the inspiration of Scripture. They're not atheists. They're martyrs, liberals, who deny that this is God's book, inspiration of Scriptures. You know, one of the most familiar passages to us are two of the most powerful along this line. 2 Timothy 3:16-17. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect or complete. Truly furnished, or completely furnished, unto all that worketh or is good. Now, internally and externally, the evidence is there to easily prove to an honest person that the Bible is inspired. 1 Corinthians 2:13, Paul said, "Which things also we speak, not the words which man could teach us, but which the Spirit teaches, combining spiritual things with spiritual words." But there are those who attack about it. You know, when I began to preach the gospel, almost all religious people believe the Bible was inspired. Now, the denomination world misapplied it and that kind of thing, but you know, they would argue, contend, that this book is God's book, inspired. And now, both without and within, sometimes we find people who deny it. There are those within the cause who deny the virgin birth. Now, anybody who denies the virgin birth, regardless of how pious he may claim to be, is an enemy of the cross. I have here some articles from Rudolf Shelley and Mike Coates' paper called Lambskins, and this one is entitled Christmas at Matthew's House. And I don't have the time to read a lot of it, just let me read a little bit. It's blasphemy. This man, Andre, Resnick wrote it. "I'm at Matthew's house for Christmas, and Matthew is sneaky." Can you imagine referring to the inspired writer of the Bible as being sneaky? "He's almost too matter-of-fact for me. I need some information. I need some exclamation marks. Maybe a couple of winks, a raised eyebrow here and there, a guess. suddenly remind us of other scandalous women. And then he just goes through several of the bottom, several places, and talks about other women and implies that they are immoral. This is what he says about Ruth. And Ruth, years with Ruth. Well, just what was she doing out there at the threshing floor at Boaz's feet? And why did he want her to stay there all night? Yet leave before they lie. Not that anybody see her.
Maybe you need to know what's going on.
studies the Bible stories again, we may see that Andre has served us by involving us in the Bible in the way that we have missed. How in the world can you make an impact on verse to verse like he does and he serves us? Yeah, this service, he says, service. We are grateful to Andre for leading our thoughts in this direction. Well, I'm embarrassed for him. And we are grateful for Andre's faith. How in the world does a man have faith in the fact of the Bible? That's the virgin birth. A faith which we believe evolved in the virgin birth of Christ. And that's a good question. If he really meant to attack the virgin birth, what could he have done more different than he did? I was down in Alabama a while back and made mention of this. One fellow was about halfway trying, a preacher was about halfway trying to defend what this fellow had done. And he said, well, what do you use in the literary form? And so when I asked him the question, I said, all right, now you tell me. Whatever form you want to bring up, how a man can attack the truth and still be an advocate of the truth of the Word of God. And he finally said, well, I see your point. We're grateful to Andre for leading our thoughts in this direction. We're grateful to Andre's faith which we believe goes to the virgin birth of Christ and the resurrection. May one rise up to call us continue back to the Bible and us to live in faith. Well, I say I hope no more rise up like this. Anybody who believes what he said is destroy their faith. Well, then here I've come with my sister likes another, her sister. And she finds and doesn't find a name. I can't blame her for my sign, I'm sorry she wrote it. She said it is obvious that Andre believes in the virgin birth. Now, how do we get the idea that he believes in it? That'd be like saying the Fox believes in the technology. That he believes in the virgin birth. I do not know how critics would have even thought otherwise. Now, you know I read this, and some of you knew about it anyway, and have it copied, and some of you maybe didn't. Would you have thought he would? Well, he was upbuilding and upholding the virgin birth, or would you have thought he was attacking? Listen, anybody would know he was attacking. Is there? Honest and sincere. I do not know how critics have even thought otherwise. The whole article is about that. Andre's mistake, I suppose, principally for the critics, is that he just put this in modern-day language. No, he just put it in the language of air. He didn't put it in some kind of form that's a little different. He put it in words of air. That's exactly what it is. He said, I'd like to suggest that you stop reading those publications that are trying to get into the truth of the fact of something. In other words, let us attack the truth, and somebody then exposes the false teacher. Don't read that. One cannot get the truth by listening to someone hammer another person down. Well, what do you think this fellow was doing? Wasn't he hammering down the truth of the Bible from word to word? These fellows do not have special license to go and attack the truth and then expect nobody to raise the voice. And then she goes on and says, we do not take such papers anymore. When I do have to read something like that, it angers me the way that they jump to mean spirit to conclusion about something they used to. This man, Andre Reisner, believe there, that I do believe there is a good in the divinity and birth of Jesus. Well, that's not what he said in that first article. As I said, he was attacked. Then he says, I wrote the article because of my deep love for the Lord and his church. Well, if that's the way you show deep love for the Lord and the church, then I don't believe I'm going to show it to you if you go out and attack me first and first. He says, I wrote the article because of my deep love for the Lord and the church, not to show a disrespectful either. I regret that the article left a wrong impression concerning those important matters for some. In other words, you and I just got the wrong impression because of that fault, is what he's saying. I don't believe that. I tell you, brethren, it's later than a lot of people think. Now, the 7,000 have not bowed to me, and this is a congregation that's not. But all brethren will stand, you brethren stand with me. And where Brother Vic is a preacher and the elders of that congregation stand, there are many brethren. I know many brethren, you do too, if you know there are many brethren that will stand. The 5,000, neither literally nor figuratively, have bowed to me nor will bow to me. But I'm telling you, the conspiracy is strong and is almost outlast point in a lot of places. Well, I want to talk about another matter. Here is an article from the National Concern, January 13, 1991. By the way, I was in Charleston, West, South Carolina, and a meeting had left, and it was featured in their paper. You know, that went out on the newswire, all over lots of this country, maybe even abroad. It's entitled, Conservative Churches May Foster Incest. Yeah. said Jesus said it. Neither pray I believe alone, but them also which I believe on me for their word, that they also may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one of us, that the world may believe without sinning. He said, the fact that Jesus asked that we would throw the cap rope around all those who just believe in him and pray and work for unity of all believers. And he goes on and says that they didn't have to believe the same thing. There never was even one division between the Father and the Son. That they all may be one. Notice, as thou, Father, art in me, I am in thee. Notice, that they also, that means in my name, that they also may be one in us. Now why? That the world may believe without sin. You know, Acts 4:31 says, the multitude of them that believe with one heart and soul, and not one of them said that all of the things which he said were some, but they had all been come. Now they were one heart, but we believe with our heart. Therefore they believe the same thing. Paul said in Philippians 3:16, I want to bring to you the thing by that same rule, let us walk. Now in Ephesians 5:17, wherefore be not advised, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And even the brethren, Paul said in 1 Corinthians 1:10, now I beseech you, brethren, of the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that ye all speak the same thing. And that there be no divisions among you, but that ye perfectly join together in the same mind, in the same essence. Don't you see what I mean when I say that there are different approaches on trying to get us to fellowship denominations or to be determined in one? Now, I want to make sure that I take the time to discuss another serious problem. And those that we have to be disheartened is the cause of Christ. That are those who are seeking every way they all have for a guy himself to put women in the pulpit as Christians. Now let me say this, I have high regard for God and women. I always have. My wife and I have 3 daughters, all of our boys are school girls. And I love my daughters, and I love my wife. But they are not the preacher of the gospel. There are other works that they do that I can't do. They're not the preacher of the gospel. You know, a good woman is more valuable to a man's spirit of God in other ways than even as I have described. You know, in Proverbs 31:10-12, look, you find a virtuous woman, for her vices far above her reach, the heart of a husband that forsaketh such in her, so that he shall have no good fault. She will do him good and not evil all the days of her life. There are good women like that in Sardis tonight. That's a long chapter, but let me read a few more verses in verses 25 through 31. Strength and honor are her clothing, and she shall rejoice in times to come. She opened her mouth to good, and in her tongue is all kindness. She looked well in the ways of her household, and even on the bread of Adonis. Her children rise up and call her blessing. Her husband also, and he praises her. Many daughters have done virtuously, but thou excellest them all. Favor is deceitful, and beauty is vain, but a woman that feareth the Lord, she should be praised. Give her the fruit of her hand, and let her own works praise her in peace. We honor good Christian women, all women, in fact, we cannot. Some women are not worthy of honor, but those we can honor. And we feel sorry for those we cannot honor. But that does not mean that women are to violate the will of the Lord, and faithful women do not want to do that. You But I still remember that that brother, the old brother, answered him very well, answered the brother, and he misread it, tied a suit. And this man actually, well, had it in his mind so strongly that he said, home, he said, you know, tied a suit once they could speak up, and then you would become sound doctrine. Down in verses 3 and 4, having said the elder women and the 50 young women, and having given qualifications to the elder women. The thing that keeps the young women to be sober, to love their husband, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husband. That's the word of God, the young master. And Brother Powell said, now this says that women can teach the elder women to teach the other young women at home. And the man said, yes, sir, that's what I said. Brother Powell said, it's a great thing. It doesn't say at home. It can be done in the classroom or wherever it's appropriate. I went to hear Curtis, Brother Porter, Curtis Porter. That's before he involved in the anti-gun movement. I heard he and Lester Hathaway debate the subject in New Orleans City. That's where I grew up. Brother Porter did not send him to Hathaway now. He moved into the New Orleans where he works at, so I've been told. You know, these fellows all go from one extreme to the other. Not all, but some of them are taller than others. But that night, they were the largest congregation in that county at one time, back before they got so far out in their anti-Sunday school thing. My father was even saying, you know, in some days, they have 7,500 something, maybe 75 baptisms in some meetings. And they would have brethren out there who taught the truth and preached where they had Bible classes, women teaching other women. But they did preach against it. I told them some of those brethren, I said, if they ever had me, but didn't preach the truth on it out there. And that night when I walked by, this man, I never shall forget his words. He said, you didn't have to wrap your pencil taking down what Porter said, and I said, for Brother Bowler, he gave account for it. And then that group of many Sunday school preachers this council had, and they made it in well. You know, all of them talking at the same time and challenging me for it. And one of them took his propositions out of his pocket, he had been looking for one, he just stood in the face and said, now you're not a coward, Simons. And I said, well, now listen, I'm not a coward, but I won't sign anything until I see whether or not it says what I believe. So I took it home, and I said, I'll take it home, but if it says what I believe, I will sign it. So I took it home, but I took it down to the door of the top, I was just about 24 or 5. And I knew I needed all the advice I could get, the moderator for me. But you know what? I said in that delay, this fellow in Pittsburgh, California, we had it in Middleton City. I said to him, in the assembly, we have our classes and then we come together in one place in the assembly. You know, more recent years there than there was already for the divided assembly. I pointed out we didn't have a divided assembly when the church came together in one place. We had the Lord's Supper and everybody was there. And I said, you cannot find among us a congregation that would have two assemblies of the Lord's Supper then. Certainly both of them at the same time. He defined it now, but it would be scriptural. So, you know, I had to face that at the end of the section. But now we have people who've gone to the opposite extreme, and they're over here wanting to win the police. And that's just wrong. That's wrong. That's wrong. I never made a mistake in that debate, and I believe it's true, that a woman can teach any number, any time, anywhere, as long as she does not deserve authority over the man. She can never do that. I want to show you or read to you something that, if you don't know about it, will amaze you. I was in a meeting not long ago near Nashville, Tennessee, and I went to see Brother Howard Green and Brother Elkins, who's the region head bypass surgery, and he bought this book. It's entitled, I Permit My Woman to Remain Shackled. Sounds like somebody thinks we're shackled somewhere. You know, when I was in Virginia, they were talking a lot about freeing women and so on, and one of our elders bought his wife a lawnmower. You better watch it, you get more freedom than you want. But anyway, he said, brother, I have to go to has 165 pages in it, let's see, that's 165. And if I had read the first, and I've gone through the book, I need to go back and get a little more carefully, but I've gone through it, it's been long, see what it's at here. You know, the conclusion by the brief, I believe the conclusion is the same as an initiated divorce family. They could usher it. They could pass it, the Lord's Supper, and all that, all the things here, leave the scene, and preach it. But you know, sometimes you reach the conclusion that's exactly what they're aiming at, and the only thing that's understood, especially if they get caught. But you know what? I don't have to tell you what I conclude about it. In this last chapter, chapter 20, and it only has a little more than 2 pages, he reached his own conclusion. And I'm not going to tell you who wrote this book first, and maybe I'll have time at the end. But I want you to listen to it. Visualize with me an unusual, but not an unscriptural scene. I'll tell you, it is one of the most unscriptural things you've ever imagined, you'll see. It is Sunday morning, and we walk down the hall of the Educational Institute of Church. We peek through the window on the first floor, and the elder is teaching to the middle-aged man on the subject of bishops, elders, and shepherds. Next door, the minister and his wife are teaching a next class on family relations. I have always been opposed to team teaching before a mixed group because when the woman speaks, even though her husband may be standing there, she's in charge and exercising the men. She's in violation of her duty. But across the hall, an older woman, an older lady, who spent 40 years in mission field in Africa, is teaching a mixed college class about mission work. So she's teaching in college. Next door, a convert to being instructed on Christian growth and maturity by a godly older brother. In another classroom, a sister who recently graduated from a Christian university with a major in biblical languages is teaching a dozen men and women New Testament Greek. Down the hall, a Christian woman who is a trained psychologist is teaching a group of recovered alcoholics and their mates, so she's teaching music. In another joint, a Christian woman who is the head of the music department at the local Christian university has a large group of men and women, studying worship and training them to read music and lend voices to more effectively teach and monitor themselves. All right, so she's teaching on the subject of music. And doubtlessly, he was objected to talking the women as well as men how they sing because this moment later he said, who's the singing? I believe this to be his own words. In the sermon of the woman, the new youth minister is teaching teenagers to resist Satan and live for Christ in this sin-pressured world, pressured world. She, the youth minister, the girl, she recently graduated from Christian University. The teenagers have already learned to love and respect her. Down the hall again, and women are teaching classes of children from cradle to old age. After classes are over, and I said he wouldn't object to this woman who was singing, and he's going to say that. After classes are over, the congregation gathers in the auditorium. A brother calls the meeting to order and welcomes members and visitors. He encourages everyone to shake hands and be friendly. The church members spend 5 minutes shaking hands, hugging, greeting one another, holding kisses, and blessing each other as biblical and commanded, and extending hospitality. But I read, why not wait until you get into the assembly? In the worship assembly, then you do this. You ought to do that before and after the service, not in the assembly. That's not what you're doing. And further on this matter of holy gifts, I know Romans 16:16 says, greet one another with holy gifts, the church of Christ's vision. But that was not the only way they greeted each other. Paul said, no man is seen either by word or by letter or the Spirit that the day of Christ has come up. So not that he's bound to the exclusion of others, but it was a holy gift, and according to history, usually men kiss men and women. But with homosexuality like it is, I never had one of the men kiss me, period. I was in East Tennessee, I went to the preacher from Texas, I got to the door, and another man in the church who I knew from another congregation, this man had known each other and been friends before, and they grabbed each other and planted their kiss on each other's cheek. And I got all day, and he looked at me and passed his pass over his pass, so I don't know where they do it that way. And I was glad, I don't want a man kissing me. And especially in this day of homosexuality. sister asked the church to join her in offering prayer and thanksgiving. One woman leads the singing, another leads the prayer. Another song is sung and is followed by a testimony. Now, I know the congregation didn't have to say sorry in their book. They said they had testimony. And two of my friends got up and did it. One of them was a teacher at the MSU, and the other is my dad. And one of the MSU is now dead. But I went to my dad, I talked to Brother Coates out there, and I said, you know, he writes a lot of his books. I said, Coates, I don't testify. He wrote a history. And the next time I went to my dad, I just had my teeth on him, and his sister did it, but one of his sisters, but I talked to him, and I said, listen, I want you to read something. And I went to my book party and got that book, and they quit that in the testify. And I wanted to recover out of Hoglund on how she was powerless, and I left that page until she relied on God to see her through the day, one day at a time. She thanks God, thanks her teacher for the spiritual insight she has given in her enterprise. She then thanks the church for its effort in reaching out to and doing behind people like her. She then offers a prayer of thanksgiving to God in heaven for this holy life. So we have one woman leading the same, and here's two now that live prayer in the center. The preacher, a man, preaches his sermon, and two teenagers come forward to come preach. Their father makes their confession, and their mother their pastor. This is what he envisioned. This is what he wished would happen. Three men, I say, he said they all the time to the table and all of that. Three men and three ladies wait on the communion table and serve the church. One of the ladies offers thanks for the bread, and a man offers thanks for the wine. You know, the only reason this is not being done, you know, a lot of places today, they're not quite sure they get married. But they can do it, they will. A sister who recently returned from Honduras reports on her birthday. She reports that she has established a new church in the Congo and has converted 64 people in the past year. She had a woman missionary in that faith in seconds. Here now, the elder announces, and I said that I will reach the conclusion of these first 160. But if they found such a verse, it contradicts what he said, I do not suffer in church. God doesn't suffer. That's what I'm reading. The church of God is tradition. You see, we follow truth, they try to make it appear as man-made tradition. For truth, justice gave us one cup at communion. Instituted an individual Bible class in 1978. See what it is. Quite the cup is the element, the fruit of the vine. The Lord said he would not drink the fruit of the vine. He took the cup, said he wouldn't drink the fruit of the vine, and did it drink it, he was in the beginning. There's one element of the fruit of the vine. He didn't say how many times, but one of the vine. But that's a matter of justice. I'm glad the Lord doesn't say we just have to use one thing of the age. Comment, don't you? But we must have the fruit of the vine. But see, that's not in the same class.
Done the Lord.